Welcome back, everyone. I'm John Furrier, host of theCUBE. We're live at the NYSE. This is the East Coast studio of theCUBE with the NYSE Wired Open Community. Of course, we have our CUBE studios in Palo Alto, connecting tech and Wall Street together and creating that backbone, that open network, the NYSE Wired CUBE Network. It's all about relationships, bringing the experts to tell you what's going on. We love bringing the guests. It's part of our Robotics and AI Leaders series. Got a great guest, Jim Kernan, CRO of Luxonis. Thanks for coming on, appreciate the time.
Yeah, John, thank you very much. Really, really happy to be here, thank you.
So you guys make really cool AI, spatial vision, computer vision. Okay, if folks who follow theCUBE know that we love multimodal AI, but computer vision captures the most data. Robots will all be run with vision. That is the core input to what we see as the future, what we're seeing in the market. You guys make product, you have product here.
I do.
So before we show the product, what do you guys, just quick explanation, what you guys do, specialize in?
Yeah, absolutely. The biggest differentiator, what we do relative to anyone else in the market, is that we do the edge inference computer vision like directly on this device. So effectively you're able to give machines the ability to perceive the world in the same way that humans do. So, you know, generally speaking, what I say is that anything that you are able to like view and process with your own two eyes, you're able to do directly on our device, like without any central compute, without any cloud compute. So that's the major differentiator for us.
Okay, so I don't know if we can get a picture of how you guys want to do this. Hold it up. Leave it there? Okay, we leave it there. I can see the picture on the monitor. Okay, so this is the big fat one, and it's got some labels on it. I see a bunch of cameras in here. This other one here, that is a smaller version.
Yep. So okay. These products are our new Series 4 products.
That's a nice shot, Ken. Appreciate it. All right, this is back. I see connectors. Okay, explain the products.
Yeah, so these are our newest product line that we're just launching right now. There's the biggest difference between these two is this is a stereo depth camera, so you're able to get like distance perception like on top of any of the computer vision analysis that you're going to be able to run on the camera, where this is just a single lens. You'll be able to run 2D inference for object recognition, detection, that sort of thing. If you start to talk about robots, like they're going to need depth perception to be able to move around space. And so, these cameras process the world same way we have two eyes, right? Like if you try to move around the world with only one eye open, it gets to be a pretty difficult thing. So we're basically, and the baseline between the two cameras mimics what we have as humans. So, again, you're able to move around the world, navigate space with this camera, with this one, and actually both of the cameras, you're going to be able to detect and truly understand the physical environment around you.
So what's the name of these products? Is there like a product name?
Yeah, so this is the Oak 4. This is the Oak 4S. So actually Oak 4D for the depth camera, Oak 4S for this one, our newest lines.
So D is for depth. That's like just depth of field, spatial. When you say stereo, what does that mean?
Yeah, so stereo is just like the two cameras individually, right? Like they are each processing individual images. And again, same way humans do it. Like if you open and close each one of your eyes, like you notice that you have different frames, right? So we're taking the two frames like from this camera, processing that like, within the, with a neural network inside of the camera to be able to like use that geometry to understand where objects are. So like the same way that I'm able to reach my hand out and pick this thing up, it's because I have, I have two eyes that are helping me figure out where that is.
And so this gives one here might be like the eye of the robot, right? Like Terminator, right?
It's funny you say that.
We all know, like, that we love Terminator references. So, Skynet. But this is what visual computer vision is, the input prompts.
Yeah, like a couple of things. So when I'm at weddings or colloquially, when people ask like what we do, I say we make eyes for robots. So you're spot on with that one. I'm sorry.
So take me through how this gets built. Oh, go ahead.
What I was going to say, I completely lost the train of thought, but I'd say that we're kind of the barrier, like the interface between the physical and the digital world, right? So we're taking and processing all of that physical information and allowing like the digital world, like robots, automated systems to be able to actually process and use that information.
I mean, physical AI was, that's a great term that Jensen and everyone's using. I buy into it because physical and digital merged.
Yep.
I love the digital twin concept I've had for many, many years. But it's been niched into manufacturing.
Yep.
As more of a, how do I get a metaverse for a factory? But digital twin just means you're doing simulation. So you can, I take a little bit of a, you know, liberal definition of digital twins, but physical and digital now work together because the data is digital.
Yes.
Okay. Physical's where the value is. So you can almost stretch the definition, but then there's still going to be more data coming in. I'm sure how much data you're grabbing in from these systems, you got to still go through the data.
Yeah.
You do analysis, root cause analysis.
Yeah. Again, there are a number of different ways that you can use and process the information. You know, people are doing things like creating digital twins, which in the common sense is just creating like a 3D replica of the world, right? Like, so that's the common definition. You know, we are just giving computers the ability to understand, and just automated machines the ability to understand like how to interact with the physical world. And so, if you think of traditional systems, and again, what differentiates us versus other examples is that I'll take it back a step and talk about humans, because like we obviously process the world through vision. So like 50% of the frontal cortex is designed to be like processing visual information. Our eyes themselves have about 550 megapixels of information that they're gathering in a moment, at any given moment, and like 30 to 60 frames per second. So like if you put that over the life of yourself, right? Like you process billions and billions of images at very, very high frame rates, or very, very high resolution. So our cameras are able to process information up to 108 megapixels, so not quite the human eye, but in very high fidelity, and do that to like 60 to 120 frames per second. And taking all of that information is like computationally expensive, as you can imagine, right? Like even just the throughput for connectors like can't really handle all of that information. And so if you think about a traditional systems, you're going to take that data, you're going to pass that to some central compute, or you're going to end up putting it up to the cloud. That becomes like it's costly from a latency perspective, costly from a computational perspective, and then you have these central systems that require a whole lot of power. So it's heavy from a power perspective. What we've been able to do with these cameras is take all of that information, have it all processed directly on the device, and then send off tiny bits of information. So really all I need to know is kind of like the definition of an object and the 3D coordinates of that object, and I can send that in a JSON back to a centralized compute and reduce a lot of that. And so we're working with some of the most advanced companies in the world as far as robotics, and they're really looking at us as like, okay, that information can be processed on the edge. We don't need as much central compute. We don't need as much power. That reduces the overall payload of our system, which reduces overall cost. So we're able to potentially replace GPUs and centralized compute that cost tens of thousands of dollars for something that is like $100 to $1,000.
It's like
$1,000.
DeepSeek moment for you guys. You can use the constraints, use offload here, design the system. That brings up a good question. I mean, okay, the business model, you got a nice formula there. Are you guys selling just the devices? Are you guys building fully built robots? What's the, where do you guys stop and where does the next step take over?
Yeah, we describe ourselves as a hardware company that builds software. As like we make our money by selling these devices, like singular transactions of the individual item itself. But we have this whole ecosystem that's built around our camera. Cloud application layer that helps with fleet management and deployment. We are able to capture data from the real world to help retrain models, because if you talk about the AI world, obviously like there's initial training, initial development of models, and you're putting those out, and those aren't going to perform in a perfect state in any individual environment. So you need real world training data to be able to operate your robots and your systems. Our cameras give you the ability to take that data from the real world and bring it back into your model and retrain.
Are you guys doing anything else besides just the cameras providing?
We do have a cloud application layer that people can use to.
But then you guys built.
Yeah, we've built that exactly. And like, so if you, our business at a core, again, we create the hardware. We don't require anyone to use any of the other bits of the software. The same as your laptop.
So you have platforms. So the software hardware is the key secret sauce for you
guys.
Correct.
The secret sauce is the firmware that we've built. Firmware is extremely, extremely difficult.
It's got to be small and fast.
Everything that we do is open source with the exception of our firmware and a few calibration procedures that we have in order to do, like the sensor fusion. So like that firmware with the sensor fusion, being able to put that on
smart.
A singular device.
It's intellectual property. And the open source gets you that integration open source vibe where let the marketplace innovate on top of or with you.
Exactly. We've had a number of people who've used us for very like basic use cases like a webcam. They just like the ability to use our cameras, which, you know, they're AI-enabled cameras, but they're like, hey, it's easy to program and I have control over all the sensors, so like, great, I can do that, and they want to use it just for that sole purpose.
And as we build out our studio, maybe we can get some input on how to get smart cameras. If we had this deployed, we'd be seeing all the trades going down there.
Absolutely.
Like zoom in on the traders.
There's a number of different ways that can be worthwhile. You know, as you start to see different activity of people's hands, you could do region of interest focus, and as soon as someone like raises up their hands, just have the camera zoom down on them. And
there, he's going in, typing the ticker symbol.
Exactly.
He's trading right now, NVIDIA option put April 4th call.
We do have some pretty powerful sensors. We don't want to get in on the trades that they're actually executing, but some of that stuff can be done.
NYSE shut us down as fast as we can. So
here's actually another benefit. Like, you could run something like that, and especially as you start to think of other markets like Europe, GDPR, privacy concerns are a very significant thing. You can take any of the information that you're receiving from our device and block it out immediately on our device so it never gets back to any other system. So again, if you have a connected infrastructure where you have to pass all of the data from one step to the next, like, you're invariably going to be passing PII as people are in an environment. And our device, you can blur out people's faces, you can, you know.
I mean, governance and policy is critical. That's a software innovation.
Yeah.
Again, to your point, your innovation enablement is whatever the developers want to do. If I wanted to do a funky cube setup with computer vision, why wouldn't I?
Yeah, exactly.
If I need it, but I have to code it.
We have a really great use case, and we span so many different industries. Like, that's the most interesting part about my job. You know, so we're in agriculture, manufacturing, warehousing, robotics, retail, healthcare. I'm going to leave off a whole bunch because the list.
Yeah, computer
goes on.
Vision is the killer app, and then the data access, you know, voice activation is going to be key. Give it, I always say stories drive movements. Give some stories that you guys are working on. Share some stories of how it's deployed, some people's benefits they've seen from it. Was to give people a taste of the value proposition.
Yeah, unfortunately, most of our customers are under NDA. I'll talk about loosely around some of that.
You can anonymize.
Of course. We're fortunate. We work with over 40 of the global Fortune 500 and a third of the Dow Jones Industrial average are customers of ours, and they use it in a wide variety of use cases, from navigation of robots, just like machine guarding. Unfortunately, the world has gotten to a place where, like, we are actively building machines that kill people. And I know that sounds a little bit strange to say, but like when you think of, you know, large industrial equipment, like military cars for that matter, right? Like, all of these things. And we have people who've used us for great applications just in machine guarding to, you know, recognize when a human is close to an object or a machine that could
potentially... Safety is critical.
Exactly.
Safety first is the vibe.
Yeah, so we have a great use case where one of our customers is... they're the security gate in a lot of live in-person events. They use our camera to identify the individual who's been detected to have a weapon on them. So like, once the weapon gets detected on them, they use our cameras to attach that detection to the individual's face, so security can immediately go to that person individually. So that's a
real time assembly situation.
Yeah, exactly. So
that's a generative response.
Yeah,
new data comes in. Process on the device, call some code. The latency might be not as super fast on the back end, but you want that front end latency. So it's like, it's all balanced.
Yeah, again, like the benefit of our device is exactly what you're talking about, that low latency, like, you know, high compute power, being able to do that directly on a device. Yeah. And like, anybody who is an engineer, like, if you know C++ or if you know Python, right, like, you're going to be able to be a computer vision engineer, like, with a little help from building the models and that stuff. But you're able to access that where, you know, traditionally.
And you're sending in JSON too. You can, that's no problem.
Yeah, exactly. You can send any bit of data. Like, if you want to send an emoji off of it, right? Like, this thing is a computer. It's probably like as powerful as this laptop. Like, you can send any bit of information you want off of it. It's just about the cues.
All right, talk about the competition, how you guys rate, because that's the hot area, obviously.
Yeah.
Computer vision is a killer growth area.
Yeah, realistically, we have two main competitors. One is like Intel RealSense. They create a stereo depth camera, and the other one, a Chinese-based company, like also building stereo depth cameras. The main differentiator and the true difference between our cameras and theirs is that we are able to process all of this information directly here. We're not sending it somewhere else, and so yes, we're in the stereo depth market. And as are they, and it's a critical component for any piece of technology that's going to be utilizing computer vision. But like us having, being able to bring your own model, load it on the device, you can do anything you want with it. So in that sense, we we feel like we're in a class of our own. Like obviously there are other systems, larger systems that. Obviously NVIDIA is a huge player in this space.
The demand for cameras is going to be off the charts.
Yeah, and we
smart cameras basically. They're smart cameras.
Exactly, and we pair nicely with the Jetson as well, right? Like there's going to be heavy loads for central compute as you have these large distributed systems, that are complicated systems handling huge amounts of data. Like us being able to trim that down into something very, very simple. Makes all better for central computing.
I mean, I'm truly curious why I asked you about theCUBE. I mean, are these video, would be able to use these for like some of our product? They're high quality. I mean,
absolutely.
Maybe overdriving it. I mean, we'd be like buying a GPU to use Excel.
Is that
overdriving it? Is there a use case for say theCUBE?
We have Oscar award winning directors using our camera.
For films,
for special effects ultimately. So by no means a stretch.
We're not there yet for our talk style format. But we could probably do some clever stuff here.
There's always something to aspire to.
Jim, thanks for coming on. Yeah. Give a plug for the company, what you guys are doing, the pitch. What your focus is right now, and just some numbers, share some data, give a plug.
Yeah, absolutely. Right now is actually a good time for us to be on the show. So I really appreciate it. We're actually raising our Series A right now, which will be a $35 million round. From the early conversations we've had with people, they're commenting, quite humorously, is like usually people are asking us for $35 million to build what you guys are building, and you've already done that, and now you're asking for that money. So.
It's good validation.
Yeah, good validation. Obviously we need to get over the line there, but
Do you have any patents on some of this stuff?
We have some patents within our calibration process and recalibration process. So like there's a common problem within cameras is that they're gonna be out of sync. The physical world itself, like as you apply heat to things, it's gonna expand or contract the actual materials themselves. And as you start to get into stereo depth, and it's very, very fine precision to be able to have these things function correctly. We have this process called dynamic recalibration where we're able to dynamically recalibrate on the fly. So we just filed for a patent for that, which basically means our cameras are going to be able to operate in a wide variety of environments and a wide variety of conditions. We create these fantastic edge AI cameras. They're used all over the world in dozens of different industries and dozens of different use cases. We're saving people's lives. Yeah. We're enabling
great military application here, tactical edge.
We have a number of people who are looking at our cameras for military applications. Obviously can't talk about those. That's the fascinating thing about what we've done is we've basically created this blank canvas. Of hardware that people can build around, and we have a software layer on top of that makes it easy to do all of these things. We're really excited about the number of opportunities going through the fundraise, and really our mission is to enable robots and automated systems to outstrip and outperform humans at all tasks in the physical world, right? So we are enabling those systems just by giving them vision.
Jim, great to have you on theCUBE. Thanks for coming on, appreciate it. Welcome to theCUBE and NYSE Wired, part of our CUBE Finance, focus on Wall Street, connecting Silicon Valley. I'm John Furrier here. All the action, just the trade, the market's upside down today. We're watching it very closely. We'll have a report on that. But again, we're on top of the floor. Behind us, all the action here at NYSE. Thanks for watching.
Thanks, John.